thank you for the study that you've so graciously given us for. We want to also thank you for the opportunity for us as a council to represent our fellow citizens on this council this evening. Lord, we ask that you bless these proceedings, help us to do our job to the best of our ability in a way that to be pleasing unto you, Lord. We ask your blessings on each and every one of our citizens, police officers, firefighters, and city employees, to keep them safe and upon the way, as well as our military serving in the city. We ask you to forgive us for what we've done, and we Christ's name to pray. Amen.
Amen. We join in the pledge of allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, tonight, the first thing we have is we need to approve the agenda. If everyone has had a chance to look it over, Councilman Jenkins has a deletion.
The electric substation, I think, is under the business side, and it's number two.
Okay, that will be deleted. Item number two on the new business, non-action. Do we have any other changes or amendments? Okay, and I need a motion to amend the agenda.
Mayor, if you don't mind, could I ask something? I apologize. My secretary didn't put me on for personnel, and I had a motion to come up with a dispatch that I need to get on.
Okay. Have a motion and Chief Carpenter, Police Department personnel to our new business action item, which is number 11. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Clear.
I'll go to your motion.
Cheryl was second on that. Okay, anything else? Okay, then I need a motion to amend the agenda.
Second.
A motion by Ms. Jenkins, second by Ms. Demery to amend the agenda. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Accept the agenda as amended.
Okay. Motion by Ms. Jenkins to accept the agenda as amended, and second by Councilman Miller. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Motion carries. Okay. Now is the time for guest and audience participation. I'd like to recognize anyone in the audience that would like to take the podium. Okay, ma'am, if you would, state your name and...
I have to stand behind her?
Yeah, that'd be fine. Or you stand in front of her. That's okay.
Hey, my name's Megan Bowen. My problem is, over the last couple of weeks, we've encountered a lot of problems at ball games. I pay $55 for my child's football. Okay? I spend at least $15 a month. I did not pay for my kid to hear profanity during the ball game. I did not pay that kind of money and spend that kind of money to keep it in the city. There's nothing for the kids to do here but play ball. That's all there is to do. And it's getting out of hand. It's got ridiculous and nothing is done about it. When my 7-year-old cries that he does not want to play ball anymore because of the custom hollering, I don't talk like that in front of my kids, and I don't feel like it should be done in front of my kids. I shouldn't have to pay $55 for another parent to cuss in front of my child. And it needs to be taken care of.
Okay. I with you and agree. It shouldn't be tolerated. And we do have an ordinance on the books for profanity in public places and ballparks or certain public places.
I mean, I understand hit the holler and get the ball, throw it in, but when you're slinging the F-bomb and the everything else in front of kids so bad that you have to pull the kids from the field and put them in the dugout, there's a problem. And somebody needs to stand up for the kids, for the coaches, because it was not the coaches.
It's the fans.
It's the fans.
These were parents from the opposing team.
And it was a good game. I mean, it was tolerance swimming. It was close. It was tied. When you don't like an umpire's call, you know somebody's going to say something to it. Coaches have the right to oppose their call. But parents, I could never see myself standing up to an umpire and cussing him straight to his face. I mean, that's uncalled for. It's ridiculous. And you shouldn't have to pay people $5 a month. You should keep the money in the city. Because almost every kid that I know is talking about going to play ball in Jonesboro. Well, guess what? If they all go play in Jonesboro, there's no money for the recreation department. What's the point of having it?
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Another guest?
Yes, sir. Mayor and Council, my name is Brandon Slater. I just happen to be the so-called umpire that's in question here. And I was verbally abused last night at the ballpark, and nothing was done about it. I was threatened by a parent. I told him to leave the ballpark. I ejected him off the field. Then I told him to leave the ballpark.
This was like a coach or a
He was coaching first base. I ejected him. He continued. I told him to leave the ballpark. He did not do it. Another parent started running her mouth. I told her that if she would like to go with him, she was more than welcome to, but she needed to be quiet and let the game proceed. She kept running off of her mouth. I told her to join. She didn't leave. Then I had a parent come nose to nose with me. The only thing in between us was the fence, and she was hollering profanities at me. And you know what we discussed earlier.
I don't need to hear them.
Exactly. And that's in front of the kids. That's unacceptable. I ejected her. Told her she was banned from the ballpark. Guess where she's at right now? Guess where all three of them are right now? They're at the ballpark. Their kids are still playing ball. My son's sitting here. Because I'm not going to have it. I will not. Me being an umpire, I'm not going to take it. I don't have to. It's in the rules. Then my wife gets voted out just before this game because she said something to AB. And he ejected her, but the lady that cursed me like a dog last night is still sitting in the ballpark. There's a problem here, and it needs to be addressed.
We will address it. Okay, Mr. Collins.
Talking about the pole, Bill. I'm back. I got a small problem. The church had music up in the street. They have music at the parts of the building. They go into the old containers, car drunk, nobody messing with them. I got a place for business over there. I treat white and black the same. I don't see colors. The mayor was here before him. They came and ate at my place. Nice place. But I'm getting my customers ran away behind the lid, constantly arrested. The mayor took it in his hands to come over there with Chief Johnny Ray and Chuck Carey and got on me about this lady. This lady had been up here and already talked. She extremely can't stand nothing. And my music is not loud. Nowhere in town. You have in your car. 90% of his patrolmen have been there and parked on that side, down the street. They can't hear nothing. They said, well, go ahead on front. But we have to come and recover. I don't know why y'all keep harassing me. And then the mayor came back over there. He came once for sure. Then he come back with the chief and another guy with it. Chuck Carey. I harassed him this, that, and tell him to give me a ticket if I don't know who it is in, ticket for that one, do that, that. I think it's wrong because my music is not loud, and I have a place of business, and a lot of people come there, And our police is running over there, parking. Three of them came up tonight. Wasn't there but a minute. One parked, the other parked, and one parked in the road beside. They stayed about 2 minutes, left. So they minded my customers away. And I don't know what the problem is, and I don't know why the mayor went over the police's head to come over there and take this in his personal hand, but he had. Then he did, he went and pulled up a light bill on me from 10 years ago. I thought I was burning camel lights at that time. I don't even know if I was burning big lights. But he seemed to find this, and he got this. He was at me for some reason. I don't know why. But I'm in his face. I'm not going to bite my tongue about nothing. I'm not a bad person. Everybody knows me, white and black. But I'm kind of shaky about it. You know what I mean? I'm trying to run my business, and I don't know what he got a problem with. I might have said something, but he didn't like. He came over there and talked to me. But when you come to talk to me, you come talk to me like a man. He's the mayor of the town, but he don't run the whole town. And I want him to talk to me like a man. Straighten this lady out, because they had a trail ride over there, and music was all over town. You could hear it everywhere. No police. So I don't know what the problem is. Why I can't run my business like I want to run it. My daughter over there got a place of business over there. She wanted the lights put up. We can't get the lights put up. But he said, I want to buy a business. He wouldn't buy it. 10 years ago somewhere. But that don't have nothing to do with it because it's not in my name. And so, man, I don't know what's what, but we can have to straighten some out, you know, because something just ain't right. And I don't know who's over you or who what, because I ain't a part of this business, but we're going to have to straighten some out because I've got to run my business over there. That's how me and my family make our living.
In reference to your daughter's place, the name being her bid, you know, her name, that's already been addressed. And, you know, we are handled accordingly. You know, if you and the mayor got a personal issue with each other, that's between basically you and the mayor. But as far as according to the law, we're going to follow the law. We're going to do what we're supposed to. The chief of police is going to do that. Him and his department are going to do their job. They're entitled to park anywhere they want to park in this city. You know, if you're coming up there, if it's a problem, you're not doing anything, not disturbing the peace, well, no citations be issued. And if you feel like this lady is harassing you, whatever, that's still part of the police department job to correct that. You know, as a counselor, I'm not going to step in that department. But if it's according to the law and the ordinances we pass, we're going to make sure you're treated fairly and everybody in the city.
But do you think he was fairly for coming over there?
Well, I wasn't there.
No, you're not there, but you know of it.
That's all of it.
You know personally that he came over there with the truck carrying him, right?
And it was to address the property that your daughter's name was in. But we're handling that.
No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about you.
Well, like I said, I'm not going to answer that. I don't know. I wasn't there.
Okay. You know he came over there twice. He came to Sheriff the first time. Okay. The second time he came to John Reed and Chuck Harris. Okay. I think he's going to look forward with that because I know he's doing his job and the other police are doing his job. They're constantly coming over there. They got the music thing and hey. It's no problem when they get there. And they have been parked outside there, and I didn't even know they was out there. And so somebody said, hey, man, the police out there. I go out there, and I said, what's up? He said, well, we got a call. Wasn't even playing no music. Yeah, the music wasn't even playing. And the other day, we was at the casino with my wife. I parked my place, my grabbed that, the police pulled right up. I said, what's wrong, man? He said, well, Frank, we got a call. I said, I ain't opened the door yet. I ain't been to place. So this lady got a problem. And I don't appreciate you coming over there not knowing what's going on with this lady because this lady's kind of disturbed. And it ain't nobody in the quarters. Next month, I'll bring the whole quarters up here and let them tell you what's going on with this woman. This woman is disturbed.
Mr. Collins, your time is up.
The time is up, but I want to. I'm through. I appreciate y'all handling it. We voted for y'all. Now, come up and just
let me tell audience, just my side of the story real quickly. This lady had come to a city council meeting a few months ago complaining about traffic and noise and so forth over there. And so that's when I went over there with Councilperson Demery, and we just to see his business, walked inside. It was during the day. Nothing more was really said. It looked like an eating establishment, so forth.
and I haven't heard from the lady since. Then she contacted me again the week that I came over there and was concerned about noise, privacy, parking, and so forth, and especially since the lot next to her house that you or your daughter purchased and turning it into an open air business or something over there right next to her. And she told me that she was afraid for her safety. She was afraid for her daughter's safety and that of the crowd that was hanging around there and that was attracted to that place out of a courtesy to a citizen of Winnfield. And she asked to have a meeting with the chief of police and with Councilman Hams. And I sent him a text that day and he didn't get it or didn't come, whatever. The chief and I met in my office, and when she left, Chief and Chuck Curry and I talked, and then that's when we came over there. I wanted to see what was going on that lot next to her house. And that's when you were there, and you walked up to me and began cursing. I didn't say one cuss word. You're the one that was cursing and calling that lady every name in the book, and I told you I didn't want to hear that.
Chief, ain't this?
Anyway.
Did you hear that?
I
didn't hear the curse words. I just heard you and him disagree about.
I'm honest with y'all. I didn't know cursing.
I respectfully disagree. But anyway, and so I
took care of it.
I went over there strictly to address the lady's concerns. And if the chief and the designates are Chuck Curry, Lieutenant Curry, to send some police by there, if it's running off your customers, my question is, why are they afraid of the police? If they're abiding by the law, why would they be afraid of the police department coming by there?
Pat, I'm going to tell you like this here. Everybody in here don't nobody like the police.
I would disagree with that. I appreciate our police officers. In line with their own personal safety and dedication to work. So I disagree with that statement, sir.
No,
and when our police department receives a complaint from a citizen that is fearful of their own safety and of their child's safety, I expect and appreciate the police department to respond to that complaint every time.
But I got something to say here. First of all, you're going to just have to try. You don't really know.
I think that's irrelevant.
Hold on one second. We've got to listen to you. Hear me out. Okay? You don't go on that side of the track. You don't go on that side of the track. So you don't know what's going on that side of the track. We know. So but you don't. Listen to me finish. Okay? So don't down the man because you don't know what's going on.
I just disagree with the statement.
Okay, bitch. I'm just saying the police know. They haven't arrested anybody. Hold on. Let me finish, man. Okay? Chief knows they haven't arrested anybody, and nobody put in jail. All of the issue out there is a ticket. Okay, we've discovered that the land that we're talking about belongs to his daughter. All we need to do here is put the poles up. That we need a law. Because you don't know, man. So you don't know, you don't know. So don't come up and pretend that you do know, because you don't.
He wasn't even talking about that, Mr. Edmonds.
I know the man all
there. Do you support the police or not?
Of course I support the police.
Okay. Now, let's move on. Let me go to address the utility bill. Mr. Collins came up there several weeks ago requesting those lights. Not his daughter. Ms. Hobby in the utility department will verify that. Okay? And Mr. Hobby came over to express her concerns about the lot. When I came back, and Gladys told me that Mr. Collins had an outstanding bill from September the 28th, 2010, that he had never paid. He owes the city $505.74. And now, since that came out, his daughter came up and said she owns the land and that she wants the lot. I mean,
that's correct.
It is correct. And
in the same token at the time, did he say he was going to put it in his name or was he going to put it in her name?
when he came up to ask for the lights, it was going to be in his business's name.
He couldn't put property, I mean, nothing up on another person's property, and that was her property. So if we'd have put, as a city, if we'd have put lights on that property because of him, we'd have dropped the ball on him. So what we were doing, as long as it was her come up there and say it's my property, and she had a roof up, which she does, I mean, she should be treated justly. So, I mean, we're not going to refuse her service because, you know, it's a dispute between someone. I mean, she deserves service. I mean, it's her property. So if she wants the pole, she gets the pole.
And we're not even talking about that particular, I'm still not even up to that yet, but what I was talking about, the reason that they weren't done the first time was because he had asked for them, and he owed an outstanding bill.
Well, I understand that. Yeah, right, well, I understand. But my thing was that our personnel had to look at the situation and see who property was. I don't care if it was, if he asked for it and it wasn't his property, he wasn't going to get it anyway. The person that asked for it and the property belonged to him, that's what she did. So if we'd have put it up for him, we'd have been wrong again. Well, so once she came up and said she wanted it, she should have got it.
Now, the question is, if this gentleman, you have, Mr. Collins, do you have any property now that's in your name?
No, not any.
Yes, sir, he does.
Where?
This is it. At that business there, this is it, if that's what you call it. Is still in your is built in your, and this is it, it's in your name in the utility department.
Please don't look, my name is nowhere on the property, please. I do not own it.
So he just saying he
I'm just saying in the utility office, that's well, what's on there.
They haven't changed it yet.
You know, well, they don't know to change it till you come and tell them.
But it's not in my name. I haven't changed it yet, but it's in my, it don't own to me, it belongs to my kids.
Well, if you transfer it over to them, then you never made that aware that the at the utility
it's
office.
It's in process.
So you didn't follow the procedure either. What? And so anyway, we'll get it straight. I want to treat everybody fair. I'm not trying to single anybody out. As long as there's no outstanding bills and that. Everything is, if you're operating a law-abiding business, then there's nothing to be worried about over there. But when a citizen complains about those things, I feel like it's my duty to at least hear her out and respond to the complaint. And that's all I've done.
So, yeah, you asked a question, man. Okay, you're right. You said you respond to the complaint. Or, so my thing is, did anybody have all the information that they needed before we y'all went over there? Did we have a chance to check out what she was saying and got back?
That's why we went over there.
To check out the situation.
Because
I didn't just
being overlooked. I went over there. Well, the place was closed. I didn't hear anything that needed to complain, but I didn't hear it. Went over by our house, still didn't hear it. Mm-hmm. Okay? Not one time, several times. I went over the front, didn't even know it. Because it was such a big, blown out thing, out of proportion. And I didn't hear anything like that. And then the joke rock was all, and everything was playing, and I went over by her house, and I didn't hear anything. So I don't know whether, who dropped the ball and feeding you and giving you that information. I don't know who did it. But information that you should have had when you went over there, we didn't have it. It should have happened. To me, it should have been done before you even went over there. You should have had that with you.
Just a little move on from that. But if you don't mind, I want to address something on that, because I received a complaint today. After the mayor and I met and went over to Mr. Collins' place, since then, as the mayor was concerned, so I had been sending the officers by. I took it up on myself to go over, I won't say last Friday, because now the complaints are from the restaurant, and also from Henderson Holden Park, from the complaint. We will go over. So I went over and said, just kept soaking around. And by the time, I guess for about 30 minutes, to make sure everything's quiet between the park and there, she recognized my vehicle. She called to the station, filed a complaint. I notified the dispatcher that it was me at this time that was granting her request. Well, today, over there doing the same thing. Well, at this time, she know my vehicle. She calls to Shreveport to her detective, brother, whatever.
and for about 45 minutes, I was in total disagreement with myself and him about her rights. And I said, she can't have it both ways. You know, I'm doing what she requested through the mayor and with me. Now she's following that's her rights. So I don't understand where this is coming from. I met with Mr. Collins after that was a disagreement with him and the mayor for the activities that they were planning on having. Mr. Collins and another young man, they shut it down. They didn't even do anything tonight. So I don't know what's the problem. That's what I want to speak on.
Saturday night, they have trail rides in South Winnfield.
this establishment wouldn't even open. But when he came to his parking lot, police there. Got a response for loud music. Right, wrong. It's a such thing called harassment. And when you got the neighbors around you and only one person is saying something, let me give you a prime example. Down on that dead end down there, a fellow was playing his radio, listening at a CD. She walked down the road with her cell phone, ready to make a phone call and ask and say, can you turn your music down? It's a such thing, it's a harassment.
That's why I said to the mayor to have all the information he needs.
It's a such thing as a rat.
There is another side of the mayor that you don't know.
It's a such thing as a rat.
That's what I'm saying. That's a rat.
It's a such thing as a rat. And one person dictating to a situation, something right. I like Miss grew up with, she grew up under me. I grew up under President all my life. Y'all got fault. But that situation, it ain't his fault. It just ain't his fault.
Building of it. Thank you, sir. Right.
When it says the second time,
time within 6 months, you know, there's a problem with not maintaining your animal. And something needs to be addressed, in my opinion, to help the problem of both populations. Once your dog back, it needs to be spayed or neutered. If you've lost your dog second time in 6 months.
Most of the dogs that are picked up are called in complaints by neighbors or so forth, by dogs running loose and so forth. But dogs and cats, we have a problem in retaining them, for sure. It's just whether y'all want to go with this particular ordinance. This is trying to strengthen our animal control ordinance a little bit in that we've picked up dogs and people come and get them, and a month later, 2 months later, they're running loose again, we pick them up again. I'll be up to the council's decision on this, what we do here. But it is a problem. It is an expense for the city.
I don't have a problem with it, but the only thing I'm concerned about is that we have to pick up the whole night.
This would be the same dog 2 times within 6 months.
They keep records there at the shelter. By ordinance, every dog in the city of Winnfield is to be registered at City Hall. That ordinance has not been enforced in over 90 years. If we have, they're supposed to have a tag and so forth on it.
I would love to see that be enforced and go ahead. That would really clean it up.
Well, that would definitely help a lot. And then we would have, any dog that didn't have a tag on it was picked up, then be in violation of the ordinance. And of course, they're all in violation basically now because that ordinance is not been enforced.
That's a good idea, but I think this would be more feasible.
And it doesn't say the dog animal would be put down. It just says that the owner would be required to spay or neuter those pets. But anyway, that's y'all's vote. So I have a motion.
Second.
I have a second by Ms. Junkin. You had discussion, any more discussion about it? Okay, I'll call for the vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Motion carries. Okay, the next item, ordinance 7.
I'd like to table that
old
ordinance
until further notice. Each more home.
Yeah,
work that they're
doing that
one. Okay. The next item is adopt ordinance 8.
This is an ordinance to amend section 1292 of the code ordinances of the city of Winnfield to provide for attacking on persons for the privilege of occupying hotel or motel rooms within the city of Winnfield, Louisiana, which are not as a hotel occupancy privilege tax in your native matters and provide an effective date of therefore. This is going to go to a flat rate percentage instead of a dollar rate, so that no matter what happens with rates over the next few years or during high times and low times, that the percentage will be reflected as the occupancy tax instead of a dollar.
Motion by Ms. Junkin, a second by Mr. Edwards to adopt this ordinance as read. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Good. Old business non-action items. Parks and Recreation. Bathrooms, Mr. Edwards.
We find it bold that we have buildings that got some rights over for the bathrooms. itself, like $3,300, $3,400. And that would take care of our bathroom problem. It's just not, just does not include the bathroom toilet or anything else. But I feel that we can get all of these done by $15,000 or $16,000. And that's a long way from $10,000 each. We're going to run about $3,300 each. We're talking about three.
And where are you proposing these be?
Okay, we're going to do the T and D area over there. Got a spot to pick out that we can put in there. We can look it up. It's funded probably 15 feet. All these places we're talking about, we can actually put them in ourselves. We don't require any other contractor. We can do it. We can dig up. We can get some of the trash and stuff down. So, yeah. The problem here is, ladies and gentlemen, is that we don't have bathrooms or water in either one of these parks. And what I saw last year, the women and kids going around behind trees and stuff, taking going to the bathroom, and that would never change. And we need to get rid of that problem.
Is there, it's involved in this, is there some way to secure these so that vandalism won't be the issue that we have now?
Well, they got a part that you can put on that door that you just can't go in. And the only other thing you got going for you is that each one of these areas, you assign somebody. Assign somebody to overlook these parks.
New business action items. First item is to accept the minutes from the 2015 regular meeting. Any changes to the minutes, or we have a motion to accept these minutes? Motion. Okay, Mr. Hounds, move to accept the minutes. Second by Ms. Junkin. All in favor, say aye.
Do
It's burned out, the roof's falling in.
She received notice and message. This petition, Brian's not here, is he?
So you're saying Mr. Nash is coming out, he didn't send out this offer?
He sent a notice out.
Oh, yeah, but she's got notice, and you know, I'm calling all that, but all the notices sent by the city, it was a problem.
Notice is wrong.
Okay, you want to make that motion, Dimmer? All right, have a motion by.
How much time do you want to give? We did give him 60. Thirty days.
Okay, we have a motion to condemn the Roger Well property with 30 days within, they have 30 days to tear it down and set it. All right, I have a motion, do I have a second? Second by Mr. Edwards. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Next one is Moro and others property.
This is Long Street property.
The property of Long Street, same thing. And this one, we had to appoint an attorney for Mr. Moro, because they had to go to the city of Lancaster, Texas. The mayor signed an order appointing Laura Johnson as attorney to represent Mr. Moro. She has forwarded him another letter, a copy of this, that has to return the state with his file of record.
That's correct, and although she has responded by accepting the correspondence, she has not contacted our office or made any attempt to remedy the problem. Well, if you're going to give her a certain length of time, then I'll correspond with your view and tell us the decision of the council.
We've got to get the judge to sign, and then we'll get certain the judge, and then we'll
mayor signs the judgment. So now we're talking around here. On the judgment, it's been a couple days.
Okay, we got a motion on the Ford Memorial property. Condemn.
Okay, second.
Okay, Ms. Junkin. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Demery. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next piece of property is Earl Lloyd Frederick Jr. and others. That's in your business. Really, you get off that, or on your attention.
Yeah.
Got a first and second on this one. Cassidy Martin, Office of Health Services.
How many properties there at Ford Memorial?
That's all.
30 minutes?
Any day for that, Dave?
Do I have a motion?
I'm going to version it.
Okay. All right, I have a motion by Ms. Demery and a second by Mr. Miller. Condemn the Earl Lloyd Frederick property. This is referenced by these pictures on 20 Moore Street. All in favor, say aye.
Second.
Clark wants to know if you can keep that work.
Y'all need to speak up.
Who's second?
So she can get that down.
Sure.
Cheryl.
Are you up, Susan?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, the last one is the estate of Bee and Rosie Lee Swoffer.
We got first and second on that.
Well, it was a real pleasure, gentlemen, and James.
Thank you.
See y'all on the flip side.
It's tomorrow.
It's always tomorrow.
That's in your district.
Make that motion.
I will, I'm so moved. Over days.
Okay. Now, the second from Mr. Ham. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
30 days to start, and then a couple of weeks, 30 days, and then they get started, and they get started, and you're still, so.
Along that same note, item number three is authorization for the mayor to enter into a contract with Inspections Unlimited for certified building inspection services. You should have something in the packet with them. This company, Inspections Unlimited, is through the parish users. And you will see on their first inside page that they're currently doing inspections for the following parishes and towns. And it would only be on an as-need basis for new construction, for building codes. And they also, on a fee basis, would help us with some of these condemnations. Correct. Their fees are passed along as a cost to the property owners who are building or doing whatever needs inspection. That's the way the parish operates, and I plan on doing the same. And I think they will help us also revise and look and make sure where all our ordinances are current up to the current state building codes. I recommend that we, yes, sir.
These, we're the same people who are gonna be making sure that our guests,
these folks will be our new service. Yes, sir.
I mean, we kind of have to push it. Just have somebody go out there and do it without being certified. And
Chad Parker is the certified building official and ICC certified inspector for Winn Parish, and he would be the one that the city can use also for its inspections.
Mayor, they would check what he's asking. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
So moved.
I have a motion by Ms. Junkie. Second by Mr. Hams. Any more discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Number four, authorization for the mayor to enter into a contract with a neighbor company for the East Jones Bridge and the Trueline curve areas as discussed March 10, 2015. Meeting. Cost of that contract is $22,150. Those are your two projects, Mr. Edwards, that were in your district down there that we discussed before the street program. And so. Have a motion by Mr. Edwards and a second by Mr. Hams. Any discussion? Okay. Call for the vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Number five is a resolution authorizing the city of Winnfield to submit a grant application to the FHWA Recreation Trails Program, employing the mayor as the agent of the city of Winnfield. And The Recreational Trails Program is a grant program to build pedestrian trails, sidewalks, so forth within cities, parishes, and they have to serve a purpose. If you have some questions about it, Mr. Henry Schuler is here, and he could answer a question concerning the grant. You correct me if I'm wrong, Henry. You get one application is $100,000, and it's awarded yearly. And what we're proposing to do to serve a purpose would be to tie the sidewalk in up here where it ends, I believe near Fred's, and then get it, go all the way out past the high school, all the way to Walmart. We'll have two little bridges that'll have to be constructed across where the bridges are across the highway. It will have to be done in stages over about 3 years or 4 years, because you only get $100,000 at one time, and there's no guarantee we'll get it. This is just giving me authorization to apply for it. And I think it would be a good thing for the town. People walk out there anyway. This will give them, they can stay off the bridges that way. Also, they can ride bicycles, they can rollerblade, they can skateboard, whatever on that thing going out there. It's just not for motorized traffic.
One thing,
six, a resolution authorizing the mayor to act on behalf of the city of Winnfield with respect to the Fort Lewis Reservoir Project. The Fort Lewis Reservoir Project has been talked about 40 years here in Winnfield or longer, and we are trying to move forward with that again. That is a city of Winnfield project that is for drinking water and for a reservoir for drinking water for the future. And there's a lot of hoops we will have to jump through to get this. But I'd like for the city of Winnfield and me as mayor and all as a city council to be behind this, and we will try to get this project secured and move forward.
Special call meeting and authorize somebody to.
Oh, the bank wants to.
the bank requires it. Okay. So I have a motion by Mr. second by Ms. Demery. All in favor say aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Number eight is the approval of the Housing Authority Board Member Gordon Powell's reappointment for a 5-year term. Now, on the recommendation of the Housing Authority Board, Powell has agreed to serve 5 more years and they recommended him to the reappointment. I have a motion by Ms. Demery.
Second.
Second by Ms. Junkin.
I have a question about that.
Okay.
I know they go with 5, 4, 3, 2, and it's a couple spots open on the board also now as well as that. So are they gonna come back again or who's gonna recommend the other spots? I think we're gonna try to feel it impossible, all of them.
That would be from recommendations from the Housing Authority Board. I don't know why they're vacant.
I mean, I'm just saying, we've been talking about the one guy, and he's got 3 older people. Yeah.
Okay, that'll be a good question for Ms. Farland. I guess is head of.
Who should be with housing, you know, during the table, you should be with the president. We've
already
been
appointing him, but then bring up the other.
Okay, is. Do we have a motion to table it, or do we have
a motion to
Ms. Demery, you know who in what he's supposed to be right now in reference to who in what place?
I mean, that's what I'm saying. So we need to, as a group, we need to know instead of, you know, some know and some don't. If Ms. Terry, I have no problem with her going to that position, but I want to make sure we know she's not being held accountable for some where she's not. Now, she's not over the wastewater treatment. We need to, when it comes up, if we're over the wastewater treatment, we need to hold him accountable for that position. You know, and she's being accountable for her position, whatever that is.
What is her responsibility? What's she going to do?
She, in the ordinance book, there's a whole paragraph about public works director. And she's basically responsible for overseeing everything from the streets to public, everything that entails public works now.
Approve the contracts and everything, the overlay and all this stuff also?
She's involved in all of that.
And it's also in the ordinance book that supervisors are responsible for their areas. You know, so we need to know.
And they report to me.
Right, and we need to know who they are. And that they're doing what they're supposed to do in reference to the citizens.
At the last meeting, Mr. Hams, you sat here and asked me after the meeting that you would like to meet with the department.
Well, we hadn't had that time to do that yet. We haven't been to that church. It's no fault of mine, but I mean, I'll get to that when I get to that. But we're talking about this right now. We're talking about putting people in place where they're supposed to be, so there we have responsible people, and we know who's responsible for doing certain things. Ain't no need to me saying that Terry's responsible for, okay, wastewater treatment now, and she's the public works director. We have to hold the guy that's down there accountable for it. That's what I'm saying.
She's responsible.
What are the supervisors behind her responsible for? Nothing.
There's areas.
That's what I'm talking about. There are areas of what we're talking about.
If he screws up, she's responsible.
Right, I understand that, but I'm just saying they got to be responsible for the areas where we don't need no resilience in the supervisor position. We need people that know what they're doing there. And she able to take care of her position. They need to be able to take care of their position. I don't have to go to her for everything. That's going to make where I think. We need to go for them. If he was responsible for the street, he need to be responsible for the street. Or we get somebody that's responsible for the street. If they responsible, so that's what I'm talking about. This business as usual, that people just run around, we don't even know what they're supposed to be doing. And they don't either. That's what we're going to stop.
Well, if that's the case, then you need to come talk to me about it.
Well, I will.
Okay.
When that time comes.
Well, I'm inviting you right now.
Well, I'm not coming right now, but I will. Well, we hadn't had that opportunity, Mayor. The day we came to meet, you had to go out of town. So I didn't worry about it. So now I'm talking about it now.
Okay. Mr. Hammond, Al Brown, he's been the manager since November, since I left.
Well, but see, that was something we didn't know.
He's working, he's still working under my certifications. He's working towards getting certified. He needs to be a level 3 wastewater treatment plant operator.
Right. But see, and I appreciate that, but like I said, I didn't know that.
Since I've been moved temporarily, I think it was in November, he was placed as manager, and I'm still working with him.
Okay.
And sending him to school.
We haven't moved men without council knowledge. That's what my problem is with. I don't know. So if a citizen come ask me about it, I can tell him, I don't know. I mean, this person's supposed to be there, but it's somebody else there.
We should have known already.
I'll make every effort to communicate. And I thought I'd called all of y'all in when we went through this reorganization back before when we lined that out. And I had a little graph drawn out, and we talked about it.
I wouldn't know if I asked.
If y'all have some questions, my door is always open. I'll try to make a special effort to make sure I communicate better if that's what y'all feel is the problem.
Well, Mayor, I'm in good with you here. You said if y'all, I mean, if you and Gerald, if you want to join the city, I'm going to come to you for myself. So I appreciate
it. I mean that on an individual basis. Because we can't have more than 2 at a time anyway.
Yeah.
That's what it means, all of it. I'll be glad to communicate. But I want to say this in here in front of everybody. The supervisors report to the mayor. They only report to you You, or you. Now, if you go tell them to do something, then they do not have to do it without checking with me first.
We're not going to tell them to do anything, but we don't like the one that's in place and he's not doing their job. We're the ones deciding they're going to be there or not as well. We vote on them in that place. The council, not the mayor. Department head.
And you feel like someone's not doing your job, their job, then you need to come in.
And I will.
Okay. All right. Now, going back to the vote on Tara Keith for acting public works director.
Second.
Here we have a motion and a second here. All we need is a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Thank you, Tara.
Congratulations. Thanks, Tara.
Thank you.
Doing a wonderful job.
Okay. Number 11, the police department. Chief Partner.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor Carlson, also the Public Safety Committee. I know how y'all feel about this last minute stuff, but this was dropped in my lap probably about 2 days ago. Part-time dispatch informing that probably tomorrow or next week that a person raised me that she probably would be able to perform her duty. So left me quickly in an emergency of getting the dispatcher hired and trained. But I went through the application and I looked, I have one from a dispatcher where she worked real well and she went to Monroe. But she also moved back here after her father had passed and she's already trained, but I have not had a chance to contact her. She talked to me about 2 weeks ago, so if you don't mind, I'm gonna put two names across and if I'm not able to get her, then I have another one that we will work up on, if it's okay. It won't interfere with the budget.
We have Public Safety Committee team meeting. We have a special meeting on the 15th for our budget.
So you could.
So we could bring that in at the same time.
This is something you need right off the top?
Well, I mean, it's so nice to get a trying case that don't work. That's next morning she might leave out tomorrow, the way she got.
Okay, we call the meeting tomorrow, Thursday, whatever you all want.
What is it, 48 hours?
After 24 hours.
Okay. I can do it tomorrow or the next day.
Have to be Friday.
Friday, right?
That'd be fine. I'll just table everything until y'all can set up the name back. So I can withdraw everything.
Right. Gotcha. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Okay. The next item is new business non-action. Ms. Junkin, I'll let you take over right here.
I am just pleased as I can be to do this. This is a proclamation from the city of Winnfield. It says, whereas Mr. Casby Moss has dedicated his life to the service of law for the citizens in the Wynn Parish community, we are extremely grateful for his contributions and are hopeful for continued contributions in the years to come. And whereas Mr. Moss has been a remarkable champion of the law, one who has dedicated his life to justice, whereas we are impressed by the outstanding achievements and even more noteworthy, we believe the many examples of leadership positions that Mr. Casby Moss has held. It is obvious that public service is a central value in the heritage of Mr. Moss, as evidenced by the Louisiana Bar Association that he has represented for 60 years. And now, therefore, Kai Bevel, Mayor of the City of Winnfield, do hereby celebrate 60 years of public service. Mr. Casby Moss is an indispensable figure in Louisiana legal history, and we proclaim June 11, 2015, as Mr. Casby Moss Day in the City of Winnfield.
Thank you.
Thank you.
thank you, I appreciate this. Sarah called and said they wanted to be at the city council meeting tonight. I looked on the wall, I saw my occupational license was up to date. And I checked with Herman, they go for citations or tickets, at least if we won't go on right now. Hanging over my head, so I'm glad to find that we're here for a total disagreement. But I greatly appreciate this, thank you.
Above the fold.
Okay, on three, one, two, three. Cheryl's hiding back there.
Accepted the bid last month for $367,000 and some change for the main street was in the street overlay, which is being done right now. And then Mr. Hams had Lucky Street, which is in there, White Street,
Lennox
Street, Clay, the rest of Clay Street in your district.
Four Mile to Main Street, Four Mile to Play.
And you chose not to do a street, but do the fix those two areas that we just talked about and get the bids for. And so there's we have a bid packet right there. It's got maps in it of the streets that are being done and so forth. I could have Henry's here if you'd like to ask him some questions.
He being me. Well, what can I clarify for the council to make sure we're on the same page?
Only thing we're looking for, like we brought up at the mayor's event, and that's the actual cost. We will look, we were kind of upset with both of y'all, because neither one of y'all came to us and asked us to go with you when you were going through our district to pick up streets.
Okay.
So that
that's nobody goes. What the way it's worked for years, and if you want to do something different in the future, that's y'all's prerogative. The mayor goes to each council member and says, what street do you want to do? Or streets. In years past, it was give me three streets. That's typically what we look for. We try and divide it as evenly as possible. Some streets are worse than others. Ms. Demery picked White Street. That's a bad street. That's why it took all of her money in one street. Clay Street, McDonald Bottom, whatever you want to call it, that's a bad street. It took most of Matt's money. I don't pick the streets. I don't have a thing in the world to do with picking the streets. We didn't say anything, but we didn't send you kicking the street.
The council comes.
We wanted to go along with you and see what you do and how you do it. Okay?
Okay.
All right, so, and the cost, approximately cost, so we don't know where we are for the next street, next year. That's what we're looking at.
The cost is in the bid. I mean.
Right, I have a copy of the bid tab right here, and that's, again, that was presented when y'all awarded the contract to Amethyst. Before somebody asked, why did they start on Main Street? I have no idea. That's their prerogative to start what they would like. Also, when their contract actually, notice to proceed is what binds their contract time. They're not even supposed to start until June 15th. They popped up one day and said, we're coming. So I said, great, get after it.
He called me on Friday night and said they should start Monday. And I said, he said, you got a problem with it? And I said, no. The way the rain is in, if we had a window to, for them to come, we needed to take it. So.
Well, my only question was, I mean, I know we all had, I think, two streets that we all picked. So is only one street getting done to your knowledge instead of two?
Well, typically, you give me two, and we look at it and see, okay, where would the money, how far would the money go? Now, if in the future, we're going to sit down with each individual council member and I show you, okay, here's soil cement, here's manhole adjustments, there's nine different things.
That, sure, it's a sure. They got more cost. You have to break it down.
Well, that's the cost.
Huh?
That is the cost.
I understand. I mean, you have to break it down. How was it done? I don't know. If you tell me, it's just going to cost you $15,000 to do this, okay. Now, X amount of dollars that me and the mayor and the governor discussed in our district, right. I'll know then. How okay. To go forward.
I think I can answer your question very, very specifically. Okay. South Road is your street, right? That's the one that's the concern, okay? I can tell you that for next cycle, I don't divvy up the money, I don't approve change orders. That street's going to cost a full 50 grand to redo it from end to end. Those big cratered out spots, absolutely agree with you. It's a street that needs to be done. But it wasn't on the list before. It's going to cost 50 grand in the future to redo. That's up to the council to decide when it's done. But that's going to be right at 50 grand for you. That street.
That's what I want to know.
There you go. Okay.
Well, how much was Lucky Street?
I don't know.
That's me either.
Honestly, I don't have that. This is a full bid tab of everything. I understand what your question is.
That's
I can't answer.
Yeah.
I can't.
Because I mean, it might have been the area like when I had Lennox Street down there, and it was a particular spot on Lennox Street, but I'm like, well, I know this could have been down there and seen it was this spot that I was talking about.
Actually, I didn't want to do anything in your district because there was a pending block grant that unfortunately wasn't funded, but I think that was explained to you why both of y'all picked streets that were in that, it was like an $800,000 job, so that would have messed up all of it. Unfortunately, it didn't get funded, but I understand what you're asking. Yes. We just need to be more specific, right?
That's all it is.
And when are we supposed to submit for our next?
Typically, in the past, that's always been a problem, is the promptness of the council members getting back to the mayor. So for us to keep it within the right fiscal year, so the citizen doesn't fuss at us, the accountant doesn't fuss at us, we need those as early as possible. So have a mental note for the every street cycle, say the end of February, would be a good mental note. Every year, we need to know what streets you're on.
So ours for the next project should already be given to you?
No.
Okay,
I'm saying
ours for the next project. So by the end of February, we should have already submitted what our
that's
number
right.
One and number two priorities are.
That's right.
And see what how much we can get done with number
that's
two.
Right.
Okay.
So you let me know now, but done.
You're on the list already.
Right?
I understand. My 50,000 gone. Huh?
On Grove Street, right. But at least without getting gypped this year, those two spots, let me make sure you know exactly what we're doing. We're widening that. Everybody calls it a bridge. It's not a bridge. It's a culvert.
Yeah.
We're widening the spot on East Jones at that big culvert. We're also putting a little head wall. I don't know who lives there. The guy that lives right next to it. You've got a crater hole right next to this driveway. Completely agree with doing it. We're putting up warning signs and we're widening that part of the street. The more expensive of the two projects you wanted to look at,
tree vine in the church that's right adjacent to it. Scared the dickens out of the ladies at church yesterday. But we're concrete lining that ditch. Again, I don't know the guy's name. He was outside. Went and spoke to the gentleman.
Yeah.
He said he was tickled to death of what we were trying to do.
Yeah, because it's washing away.
Well, he said he pulled people out of the ditch and all that too. So. Yeah. I want to make one comment that has nothing to do with the street overlay program. You can do whatever you want. You the council, that's come up 50 times tonight. Y'all the bosses. The bathroom you're talking about, it's ironic that you're approving the contract for utilities for inspections unlimited tonight, because I just want to caution you, you got to make sure everything is up to code. If I think I heard you right, there were some things that your own building inspector wouldn't authorize you to do and allow you to do. So there's ADA compliance issues. Even if you say, well, there's not a wheelchair person anywhere near there, it doesn't matter. You have to build it. If it's a new bathroom, did I hear that right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Got to be ADA compliant. Got to have state plumbing code certifications. It's got to be done by people that have the license that you set and said, oh, do we know it's a certified plumber? Do we know this? Do we know that? Well, you got to abide by those same rules. Just FYI.
Yeah, I knew it was a lot of detail to it. But I already talked to the park director, you know, and asked him to at least start looking into whatever the codes are for us to go about doing it. So.
Again, I'm not against it. I'm just trying to. Anything else? To be more specific, is that?
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody knows what we're doing for this year.
That's it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shure. Okay. Next item on our agenda is American Wastewater Management, Mr. Edwards.
Yeah. Gentleman there?
Yeah. Carl Johnson, who's the supervisor for American Wastewater here. Answer any questions?
We'd like for you to bring us up to date, sir. Okay. Sometime between Sunday, the 25th, and Memorial Day, after 11 o'clock Sunday, after I checked, the ozone plant went down. Eric, my assistant, we were talking back and forth with Wayne. There was a probe issue. We had one overnight. The plant run approximately what they had and probe went out. And we've been down until today, plant here. And basically what we have to do is bypass the probe. We're doing something. Wayne can explain more to you about the probe issue. But there was nothing we could do to get that going. I did everything possible. We flushed lines. I know people call talking about how it was running. We up the chlorine, we flush lines every day to do everything I could possibly do to keep the water clear. But it's back going now, and the water is clear, but it's going to take a few hours to get out of the system. And anytime that ozone plant goes down, nobody can say, I don't tell you, because within 12 hours, you'll know if it goes down. The water comes through Winnfield just that fast. That's how much water the citizens use. So if it goes down within 12 hours, all the tanks are refilled with dirty water. So you'll know. Everybody. So
is that the same thing where it's back online? It's about 12 hours
before
it clears out. And what time was it back online today?
3:30.
3:30.
2:30. 2:30. So do the citizens know? They're notified, ma'am?
We put it on our Facebook page.
Yeah.
Okay. But the water is safe. There's no reason, you know, it's not like a boil water or anything like that. The water is safe to drink. It's just discolored. The city operated for years without the ozone plant operating, and we have invested money and gotten back up. I had just commented the week before it went out how pleased the thing was running like a top since we cranked it back up, and then the next week the probe went out, so I guess I cursed it, but.
But we were able to clear some, the water's clear now. We were able to clear it up with a little more chlorine flushing, but to top it off to have it good, we have to have those.
The other question is, if we have a line that busts, then how do we know, who are the first people going to know when this line busts? You know, when are you guys going to find out? Because if you find out 2 hours later, that means we have lost a lot of water.
Okay. The way line breaks, that goes to the distribution system. That's right.
They're not on for distribution.
But they do notify me when the pressure loads, because when it breaks, I have to monitor the well and make sure that water is still pumping. So we have a group effort we work with. We've had several leaks. I can run the well manually from my computer, and I can adjust it according to water pressure. Everything is computerized. So if they call and say they have a leak, I can keep up with the water pressure and know whether I need to turn one well on or two wells. But most of the time we know, because if somebody calls for low pressure and it's just one side of town, it's a leak.
But we won't know where the leak is.
That's when we have to dispatch and go find it.
I'm saying you said it's computerized, but we have no other way. How do we just go and find this thing?
If there are ways to isolate it and open fire hydrants, and if this one's got a little more pressure than that one that was lower, you keep going down the line. You just have to trace the lines. There's no way to just actually, when it starts leaking, go right to it, unless you see it. I mean, it could be a leak in the middle of the woods.
And we're trying to find and search out any possible leaks, because unmetered water running out on the ground is
And another program I'm telling you that we have been working, we cannot find it. We are trying to find a map of the city with all the water lines and the fire. I have not been able to locate one yet, but we're going to try to. And I have talked to the mayor and Tara about inspecting. We've got lines out in the woods that probably have not been inspected ever. And because we've got a big discrepancy in what we're producing in water and what we're building. And I feel like we're losing water somewhere. So that's in our plans, to find this map so that we can survey the system.
And that was my concern, how much water we were losing, but those are dollars and cents that we're losing.
Exactly.
Right. All right.
We got a map at the fire station.
You do have one?
Okay. Do you have any questions, Mr. Wayne?
Oh, but Wayne wanted to.
And Wayne, if you have any questions about the ozone plant, this would be a good time to ask Mr. Wolf. He's here to help us troubleshoot and get this plant back up and going, and work with Carl and his crew to.
I was going to give Mr. Wolf a chance to get it back online again.
Okay, but I did want to say that we are working. Wayne said today that he would like to be put on a 6-month maintenance schedule, where he comes every 6 months and go over the plant. Plug in and make sure everything's still tweaked perfect.
I thought you was already doing that.
We had.
This was his scheduled visit right here from the time when we cranked it up, and it's just the plant went down a week ago, and he sent overnighted that probe to get it back up, and it didn't last. But he is working with Carl. Why don't you talk a little bit, Wayne? I don't want to talk for you.
Okay. We were scheduled to come about 6 months after we put the plant online. They experienced a problem with a device that checks the efficiency of the half the system. The half that system is about filtering and drying air before it's used to make ozone, so that's a pretty critical step in it. And there's a sensor that checks to make sure that process is online. It's an unfortunate thing that your whole system, which is in pretty good condition, was held up by a sensor that cost about $800. It's not a device that gets much of a warning when it goes bad. We're going to try to put that sensor on scheduled rotation on a preventive maintenance program going forward, whether it needs to be replaced or not, as an effort to try to prevent this type of unexpected failure. But in general, I reviewed the plant today, and outside of some wear and tear that you would expect from a plant that's approaching 15 years old, there were some leaks and cracks in lines, which we did the inspection. We adjusted and calibrated all of the sensor devices on the platform, and many of them needed some adjustments, but nothing major. I can give you a general sense that the plant's in pretty good condition, and we'll just keep up a regular inspection. I think we can head off these unexpected events that happen.
So you said 6 months? Okay.
I think it's a reasonable interval. Because your operators don't have much operating experience with the plant, I don't think it's reasonable to expect them to be able to recognize conditions that are starting to occur before they turn into a shutdown. So I thought that if we do a regular 6 month interval, then I can be giving training and orientation to your operators so they can continue to accumulate a first hand experience with the machine. So they'll be able to start recognizing issues as they would start to trend.
All right. And I would like to say, I myself, Tara has agreed to come over, and she's going to start getting some training also.
Now, that was my next question. She was saying also, you know, going to include Tara into that.
So yeah, she was already.
Even some things she'd be able to spot without,
sure,
you know, without even you guys.
But that's it. Other thing I could say to Tara, didn't say the pandemic, he was making everybody was going over her certifications. Tara is the only person in the city right now with level 3, so ultimately she is responsible for everything. If a department head messes up something, they're going to go to her. Until somebody else gets a level 3 certification, she is responsible.
For water and water?
Water and water. Well, distribution, I'm going to.
Just a quick question. You said the repair that you made that bypassed the defective part. Is that a permanent repair that would hold, or is that like a temporary?
This is a temporary fix. The city of Farmerville has a similar plant to yours, and they have a probe in stock, and I spoke with their utility director this evening. We were going to try to arrange a swap sometime in the morning. They're going to loan one to you while you're waiting for your new one to arrive, and then you'll work out some exchange. Get there back to them. Right now, I provide the place. I did a general inspection of the plant. It's in good condition. I don't have doubts. Based on the operating logs for the last 3 months, everything's been operating in a pretty consistent manner. So there's no indication from other operations that the gas quality has fallen off. It's just we have a bad sensor, and the sensor that I sent you apparently it got damaged in shipping. It was bent when it arrived. Sent it through FedEx and tried to do our best, but it didn't get here in one time.
Now, when you go and put the new part on, mm-hmm. Can you do that within the bypass, or you're going to have to put the plant offline? And
it'll more the water plant will be off. The plant will be offline for about 20 minutes.
About 20 minutes?
20 minutes, and that's not enough. We'll cover
the
water.
But when we do that, we can turn the wheels off. You don't even have to pump any water. We just cut it off. Don't turn it back on until we.
So when you guys are doing all these repairs and making these adjustments and stuff, you are going to include Tara, right?
Yes.
So let her know, so she'll know what's going on?
When I do some repairs, we can give a report every month.
No, that's not what I'm asking.
Every single repair that I do, I give Tara a report. Everything I do, I'm going to be honest, I can't stop every 5 minutes and send it to Tara.
No, I didn't say that. I was saying, if you go and do a repair, and you are there, why wouldn't you invite her to come along and observe what you're doing?
Honestly,
yeah.
I'm not always there. I'm not sure if Tara will always have time. And when it's time to do a repair like change the filter, it's not very cost effective to call Tara over just to watch her change the filter.
I didn't say everything. I mean, you have to distinguish between what you need to know and what you know.
Well, here lately, we haven't had any main issues before we needed to call. This has been the first one.
Systems work very well since we've been online in November.
Run like a Timex, so
you use Hutch, you don't say?
Yeah, I don't. But I'm just saying.
We're glad for what you're doing, and we're glad to have it
y'all want to understand.
She been put into a position problem where she's going to be responsible.
She's not responsible for that plan, by certification.
Says you?
Yeah, see, they are responsible for the distribution.
I am level three certified in all three water, but I am just over water distribution while they have, are here with the ozone plant. They're over water treatment production.
But I think.
But Karen and I have a good relationship.
They have a good working relationship.
I mean, she's not enough out of the loop. You know, when the plant went down, I called her and some, if I need something, I call her. She needs something from me, she calls me. But I can't say to council, I don't have any emails from council. I have other cities I operate, I have all my council emails. If you guys give me your email and something like this happens, I'll see you and let you know everything that's going on. It does not, it will not stop.
What time,
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Wayne. Okay, number six, intergovernmental agreement, Mr. Hans.
Well, mine is, my concern here is just I wanted if anyone, say we noticed that the police jury, you know, they passed the parish-wide road tax, you know, for infrastructure on roads. I wanted to get, was the city able to, by a dollar figure or percentage, able to tap into it? They say what they gonna do to help us out, because they run through the city too. I got three police jurors that come through my district. So if they should be able to, since it's a city, parish-wide tax, see somebody to speak with and see what part of this that we able to obtain.
It was sold as a rural roads tax, so I don't know, they may be bound by law that it's strictly for rural roads.
They did give us $30,000 a year.
We know that, but soon as we got the call, that one really.
It didn't even pass the first time.
Neil Wagner's getting done.
What?
Yeah, they're going to do Neil Wagner.
Yeah, but it to answer your question, it does, you have to do it outside of the city. But there's a job bidding in the paper right now. The two roads that are closest to the city limits, Neil Wagner actually comes to the city limits. City limits is the driveway that goes into the housing complex there. Mm-hmm. It would start right there and go all the way to the railroad tracks. That is the single largest road in this project. That was Ms. Dion's project. She hustled for that. And then Jay Vines Road, that's another one. And then the other ones are scattered all over the place.
Well, let's get back to Neil Wagner. Where you saying we'll start here?
At the city limits and go towards 167.
Okay.
You know, last year they did the Country Club Road, Fairgrounds Road, uh-huh. Which there's, you know, that's right on the edge of the city limits, but it's not in. So they do a few roads close by, but they give us a little money, but it's not enough. Okay, any more, Mr. Hans, on that? Or? Okay, we've got the next one, policies and procedures.
Yeah, it's just for the city employees, I mean. I hadn't seen any policy procedure that where a person, the workers, really know what their responsibilities are. I mean, I'm quite sure they got the knowledge to say if I do this, it's okay or not do this. But I hadn't seen any policy procedure in reference to the city or anything they assigned, you know. And it's hard to go forward like that without having anything, you know, in writing that we're supposed to do or they supposed to do.
Can you be a little more specific?
Well, any policy procedure, any company that you establish got a policy procedure, what you do is and don't so.
I actually brought this up in last construction, and it just got brought up, and that was it.
You can't cover anything without policy procedure.
I mean, if someone gets fired for some reason, it's got to be laid out there.
Well, I guess the reason I brought it up is based on how unemployment is.
Yeah.
You have job descriptions and you know, your policies of how and who to go to, how, what rules to follow.
Protocol.
And what they're doing.
We're working on it. we put the priority on this first year has been to develop a safety program, which is policies and procedures, which we are going to present that for council approval next meeting, Susan, or?
Yeah, we've got several others. We've got a vehicle use policy, we've got a cell phone policy.
We have been working on some.
Well, I'd like to have a copy prior to that so I can read before I get to the meeting.
What we'd like to do is an ordinance that it'll be introduced and everybody read over it.
Yeah. And if we need to give it.
You're at 30 days.
Before we introduce it, that's what I was going to say. We have them look over it now.
Somebody may ask you a question.
HR policy book, we actually have that consulted with the Louisiana Municipal Association. He has a federal labor law. He used to work for the federal government. He's been a reviewer at work for free. So.
Also, termination, but he was being terminated by, and so we were executed by lawsuits and stuff like that.
Yeah.
When we terminate somebody, we only want to go up there.
It's going to have this, it has the steps in it, it has a form in it of, you know, a write up form and policy to follow.
Case and interview type forms in the write up.
Okay. Any more questions on that or?
The last one here, I'm still concerned that we just in reference to, I guess, the economic development, how, where are we going in that direction? Have we came up with anything else for reference to bringing any type of jobs in this area? I know the tractor company, but anything since then, anybody showed any interest?
You know, Arkland, which is, I call it, still call it Kimbon, but Dania, whatever, they had, they're looking to expand, and they, came and we looked at the, they wanted to see the Vassarette building, and I've showed them the Vassarette building twice, but I have no answer from them one way or another yet. Maybe when I, if I get an answer that they're going to expand here and lease or purchase the Vassarette building, you folks will be the first to know. But that's the only inquiry that we've had in recent months, and I hope and pray that that will come through, because that could be 30 or so jobs if that expansion occurs. But that's a corporate decision that we have no control over. And I spent the last 2 days of last week, actually 3 days because I drove, to Memphis, Tennessee for the second academy on this ACT Work Ready Community Initiative, which I'm the team leader for Lynn Parrish on that. And it's just to give you a quick overview, it is a initiative that's a nationwide initiative, and other states have adopted it. Rapides Parish and Avoyelles Parish, to my knowledge, are the only two parishes in the state that are work-ready certified. CLEDA, which is Central Louisiana Economic Development Alliance, which is funded by the Rapides Foundation down there, they're a group that's committed to economic development for CINLOC. And there's a lady that's heading the ACT initiative for them. Her name is Sandra Redmond. And she is heading this initiative in Central Louisiana, which is Catahoula, Concordia, Saw, Grant, Wynn, Natchitoches. I don't think I left anybody out. And I went to a meeting in New Orleans, and I went to one in Memphis, and what we're doing is developing our plan to, so Wynn Parish will be work-ready certified. Which will be a key foundation, key component for us to attract businesses to Winnfield or Wynn Parish. And that's, there's a model that's already there. All we have to do is follow it. And I spent 2 days last week from 7:30 in the morning to 5 o'clock in the afternoon, Thursday and Friday, in those meetings. So, yes, I agree with you. Economic development is important. It's a big concern here, and when I ran for mayor, I said it would be my top priority, and I'm trying to put it as that. And no one else in the parish When I became mayor, I found that this initiative was in place, and these academies were about to occur, and I signed up, and there were a couple of team members already in place from the police jury and a couple of businesses, but really no one had taken the ball and run with it. So I committed that I would, and because I think it's that important for our town and our parish. And it's taken up a good bit of time. And we've had one employer meeting. Now, that's part of the certification process, is to have get employers to sign up and say they support the initiative. We've had one employer meeting, and we had, I invited over 20. We had about 12 come to the meeting. Every one of them signed a support letter for it. And I'm going to have another employer meeting in July, and hopefully get more to sign on. The high schools are already doing the work keys testing in Winn Parish. The work keys test that the juniors and seniors in high school take in Winn Parish is part of this ACT initiative. And it all ties together to help us get a better qualified workforce. And we need that certification, because if there's other parishes around us that are certified and we're not, the site selector is going to pass us over. And so I'm committed to get the certification, and that's what I'm working on right now. There are some other things we can possibly do, and if they present themselves, we will make every effort to do it. We've got a lot of good things going for us here in Winn Parish, if we can get somebody to give us a look.
The trade school out there, Mayor, it's really need to be for the job. They need to expand. Well, I mean, who are we seeing? Who are we contacting?
Jeff Johnson, who is over at the current community college here, he's on the team, the Winn Parish team for the work rate. They do the testing for work keys. If someone's out of high school and a business sets a job profile based on work keys testing, and that person wants to apply for it, then they can go and take the test at the community college. And they have to set an appointment and go take the test. And the test is free because the Rapides Foundation, through one of their many arms that they have, pays the $50 fee. It doesn't cost anyone to take the test. That's a great benefit that we have in Central Louisiana because of the Rapides Foundation.
So the high school seniors would know about this.
They know about the testing. I think, unfortunately, the communication between the schools and the businesses did not know what was out there. I did not know what was out there. I heard of work keys. I had no idea how it worked. Now I know, and I'm a believer in it. And those business owners, when they were there at that meeting, when Sandra and I went through the program, that's why they all signed on. Once you see how it works and see how it can help you get a better qualified employee, and hear some testimonials from some other businesses like Royal Martin, Gilcrease Construction, that are using the Work Keys testing program and what it's done for their companies, you're crazy not to sign on. So we're working on that. It'll help us. It's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take another year or so of this work toward getting certified, but we're moving in that direction, and I'm committed to it.
We know that they what the job might call for.
All right, we've had a long meeting tonight, a lot on the agenda. I appreciate everyone that came and stayed through the bitter end. Thank you. And this is our 12th meeting that we completed as two new councilmen and me as a mayor. We've completed 12 meetings, and we've gotten a lot accomplished. And I'm not slighting any of you council people that are on that have tenure already, but thank you for working together. Thank you for all of us trying to move Winnfield forward. We do have some other issues this year we'll have to work through, but if we'll continue to work together and all be on the same page, and we won't always agree, but hopefully we will agree more times than we disagree. And I appreciate everyone's help and this year on what we've gotten accomplished. And we'll have our first meeting of the new year next month. So can I get a motion to adjourn?
No.
Okay.
I want to say one thing, a couple of words. I came in here, this is new, with no knowledge, obviously. And a lot of things were overwhelming and surprised. I've enjoyed working with the council. I'm enjoying working with you. And you're right, you're not going to always agree upon one thing. We're going to have our little arguments or whatever. As long as we accomplish what we need to do. I came in to help Winfield. It wasn't all about me. It was citizens in Mississippi. And it was on its way down. And we needed, I think we've done a pretty good job our first term out here and bringing it back to where we go. This won't take a long time. I think it's 6 to 8 years. It's going to take about 6 years just to get us there. Because we got so much to do. But if our citizens hang with us, I think we're going to be okay.